Hello, and welcome to today's talk. I'm your host, Mohammed Balu, and today we will discuss how Torizon by Toradex can streamline the typical embedded system workflow, from OS customization to master peripherals on your custom hardware to managing and provisioning entire fleets of devices. We will go over the typical workflow in getting an embedded system product deployed, which will allow us to understand where current deficiencies exist. Then, we will see how Torizon by Toradex can address the deficiencies at every stage of the workflow. Finally, we will also see some demos that illustrate how to accomplish common tasks using Torizon. Lastly, I would like to thank Toradex for their continued support. Not only have they continued to provide hardware to allow me to provide useful demonstrations during these webinars, but they have provided promotional and technical support to ensure that this webinar is successful. We actually have Drew Mosley at this webinar as well. Drew is a technical solutions architect for Toradex in the Tampa Bay area in the US. With a skill set in software engineering and strategic technical leadership, Drew is involved with all phases of development and testing of deliverables. He architects customer-facing solutions in embedded software, embedded Linux, and Internet of Things. Also, one housekeeping note, if you have any questions during the course of the webinar, feel free to enter them into the chat or Q&A windows, and we will address them during the question and answer session at the end of the webinar. You're also welcome to ask your question during the session at the end. Here we see today's agenda. First, we're going to take a closer look at the motivation behind what we're trying to accomplish. Specifically, we will go through a typical embedded system workflow and understand each step. Then, we will discuss Torizon by Toradex. Specifically, we will discuss what Torizon is and how it addresses the deficiencies of the typical embedded system workflow. Then, we will focus on individual steps of the process, such as OS customization and application development. Here, we will provide some interesting demonstrations that illustrate the steps in the context of the overall application we're aiming to develop. Then, we will briefly discuss deployment strategies that Torizon enables. A deeper discussion will be reserved for a future webinar. Lastly, we will conclude with a question and answer session. First, a little bit about us. I'm Mohammed Balu, founder of MabLabs Embedded Solution. MabLabs is a Toradex technology partner, and our expertise is in developing custom IoT and embedded system solutions, ranging from Linux modifications and driver development to support custom hardware to application solutions across a multitude of domains and verticals. Remember to check out our website and LinkedIn page for more information. We highly recommend everyone to sign up to our BIOS Food newsletter. Our newsletter helps you stay up to date with news, information regarding upcoming workshops and webinars, and courses. We also provide some insights and tips and tricks that we learned during the course of our own project work that can also be a benefit to you. We also discuss new developments in embedded Linux and the Yocto project. You can sign up for our newsletter by entering the QR code on your phone or going to our website. Now, let's talk about the motivation behind using Torizon. Here, we can see the typical workflow in creating a product that is a Linux-based embedded system. First, we most likely need to customize the Linux kernel. Most often, there is custom hardware in the form of a peripheral that is necessary by the end application. This customization step may require device tree change, modification of the kernel configuration to enable a driver, or to pull in or develop our own driver. Then, once we've made the necessary kernel customization, we need to unit test both our customization and the peripheral itself to ensure that the software and hardware are correct. Then, we begin the development of the actual application that the system will run and go through the necessary developmental testing of the application itself. Then, we usually need to hand it off to another individual or team to conduct their own testing against a set of requirements that they may have. Ultimately, the software and hardware that comprise the final product will need to enter manufacturing and deployment. The question becomes whether the workflow can be streamlined. As we just saw, although the image in the previous slide is concise, there's a lot in each step that requires consideration. This usually results in an extensive timeline to deliver a product, even to create a first generation to identify and iron out issues in the field. Additionally, most elements of the workflow offer too many options, especially as we get closer to the deployment stage. For example, there are a myriad of options for performing an OTA update. Each option needs to be considered across multiple requirements, and this cycle can be time-consuming. Each option can be prototyped and tested, but this becomes time-consuming. Another alternative is to perform research or use a third party. However, if a service offered by a third party is leveraged, there is the possibility that the vendor and solution may not be available when you're ready to go to production, which could become disastrous. The Yocto project / Open Embedded is a framework that can provide some reprieve. Typically, you don't choose to use a Yocto project as your framework. Instead, the vendor that provides the SOM that you're using uses the Yocto project as the basis for their BSP, and then you customize their BSP to include your custom hardware. When using the Yocto project, there are certain best practices and paradigms that can be leveraged. However, there still exists a myriad of options that you have to consider. Additionally, learning these best practices and incorporating them into your custom Linux image can be daunting and usually comes with a steep learning curve. Additionally, customizing an image can be quite an iterative and time-consuming process. For example, getting an initial build just right can take numerous hours, if not days. Finally, as mentioned earlier, even when using the Yocto project, deployment is still up to you to select the appropriate deployment strategy, from running applications on your system to performing OTA updates. Thus, the natural question becomes whether a better solution exists. Similar to how a SOM vendor chooses the Yocto project as the basis for their BSP, it would be valuable if a SOM vendor would also provide recommendations on implementation strategies for additional steps in the workflow we saw earlier. Based on their own extensive research and testing, it would be ideal if a vendor reduces the complexity down to a few simple steps, including deployment strategies and OTA updates. Now, we will see how Torizon by Toradex can serve as this framework that can address the deficiencies that we have outlined in the previous slides. Torizon is a complete ecosystem that encompasses all stages of the workflow that we discussed previously, from OS customization to application development to device provisioning, deployment, and OTA updates. It allows us to develop and test multiple applications on a target board, and when we're ready for deployment, it provides an easy-to-use web interface to provision devices and load custom images on them. Torizon includes some powerful features. For example, we can easily modify the Linux kernel in the device tree to accommodate our custom hardware. Docker serves as the basis not only for application execution on the target, but also application development on the host PC. This significantly streamlines the development process. For example, certain applications can be developed and tested on a native x86 PC. Additionally, Docker also supports ARM emulation, so we can test the application as if it's almost executing on the target device, which would minimize the porting effort, if any. Thus, we can initially focus on functionality, and we're ready to migrate to our custom board, we can then focus on final checks and performance validation. Also, the tools to create a custom image are themselves in a Docker container, obviating most dependency requirements. As we've mentioned, a web interface is also provided to support device provisioning and remote image deployment. Finally, and equally importantly, Toradex provides excellent support and documentation that describes in great detail how to walk through the workflow steps with examples. They also have a thriving forum community where questions are promptly and accurately answered. Torizon offers numerous advantages for the development process. It seamlessly integrates into both Visual Studio and Visual Studio Code. Toradex offers an extension that streamlines most initialization steps in creating, deploying, and testing an application on the target board. Major programming languages such as C and C++, Python, and .NET are supported. It easily integrates with Docker Hub to allow us to make use of applications that others have already created, which precludes us from wasting time and re-implementing the same sorts of applications. As mentioned, Torizon offers features to streamline the deployment process. It leverages proven technologies, such as OS Tree and Uptane, to ensure that images are safely deployed to devices. Torizon offers device monitoring, which provides valuable insight into an IoT node's and overall network performance. A web interface is provided, which simplifies this process. Finally, even during development, deploying an application and image onto a target board for testing purposes is also supported and simplified. Torizon offers different levels of OS image customization. For example, we can use a base image made available by Toradex and make relatively minor tweaks. For example, if we wish to customize the splash screen, customize the device tree to support additional peripherals that we want, or if we want to simply pre-package Docker containers as applications into the image, Torizon offers that support. On the other extreme, we can even customize the base image. Torizon is inherently based on the Octo project, and if we need or want to, we can create our own custom base image using the best practices and paradigms offered by the Octo project to create our base image and then use that for the minor tweaks that we just mentioned. Now, we're going to work through the different steps in the embedded system workflow and see how they can be performed using Torizon. The first is customizing the operating system, specifically Linux, to accommodate the unique peripherals that are specific to our board. Before we dive into the customization details, let's first discuss the project or application that we're looking to implement. To make it relevant to an embedded system, we're going to use a temperature and humidity sensor to measure environmental data, specifically temperature and humidity. We will then store this data in a database, specifically InfluxDB, which is meant to store time series data, and then retrieve that data and visualize it. Finally, we'll see how we can make a slight change in the application and how it affects the visualization. We're going to use a Verdant IMX8M mini-SOM with a Dahlia carrier board, which is shown here. The green USB-C cable is meant to serve as a console interface, with the silver USB-C cable serving as a memory interface to the SOM for restoration purposes. Finally, the Ethernet interface will be used to communicate with our development PC. We're going to use an SHT-31 sensor, which will communicate with our SOM over I2C. Luckily, there is a device driver that already exists in the kernel, which simplifies the process a fair bit. First, we're going to start with the Toradex Easy Installer, which is a standard image that is loaded on all Toradex SOMs fresh out of the box. This allows us to install a standard Torizon image without any of our customizations and start fresh. We will not demonstrate this step, but it is very well documented on Toradex's online documentation. Then we will install the Toradex utility called Torizon Core Builder that allows us to customize the Linux OS in the image amongst other customizations that we can apply. This utility is itself a Docker container, which simplifies the installation process. Additionally, a script is provided to set up our environment appropriately and make the tools immediately available to us. We will then download a base image for our specific SOM. We will then start applying our changes. First, we will customize the device tree to accommodate the SHT31 sensor. Then, we will apply this device tree change to the base image to create our custom image. The custom image will then be deployed to the local device. The device will be rebooted and our new image will be executed. The entire process, as you're going to see, takes approximately 15 to 20 minutes, which when compared to the necessary steps in the Octo project to achieve similar results, would take significantly longer. In the next set of slides, I will document the exact steps that I followed in customizing the Linux OS to make it easier to reference, since things may not be obvious or explicit during the demo. First, we can simply download the Torizon Core Builder script and source it, and that will have the Torizon Core Builder environment set up for us. The next time we want to apply another customization, we simply need to source the script. One caveat to mention is that we do need to make sure that the Docker daemon is installed and running our development machine before we source the script. The next step is to download and unpack the base image provided by Toradex for our SOM, which can be accomplished by running the command shown here. The concept of unpacking simply makes the Torizon Core Builder Docker container aware of this base image. Then we can actually apply the device tree change by running the first command shown here, and then verify in a rudimentary fashion that the change was actually applied using the second command. Finally, we can incorporate these changes into the base image by using the first command shown here, and then deploy to the board and reboot using the second command, and that's it. Now let's look at these steps in action with our demo. So here we have our environment set up, and we've already pre-downloaded the base image along with the Torizon Core Builder setup script. So first, as we mentioned, we're going to source the image. So we're going to run setup. And this is going through the process of downloading the necessary Torizon Core builder tools and setting them up using Docker, right? So it's creating a Docker container for us that allows us to utilize the Torizon core builder infrastructure. And we'll let that finish. And this process only has to be run once, right? Now, next time we want to do this is we don't have to go through the whole process of installing and downloading and installing the Docker container, the Torizon Core Builder Docker container, because it's already there. We just have to run that script again, and it'll just simply set up the environment for us. So now we're going to tell the container, tell Torizon Core Builder about our base image, right? So we're going to run Torizon Core Builder images unpack, and the great thing is now that we've sourced this script, the appropriate command and the options are populated for us if we hit tab, right? So it already knows about the options that we can give to the Torizon Core Builder base application. So we're going to run unpack, and we're going to run this command, right? So now it's basically going through the steps of importing this image into our Docker container. Okay. So now we're going to apply the actual device tree change. So this is where we have the actual device tree. So here we can see that we've created an overlay that basically populates this SH31 sensor onto the I2C4 bus, right? And the way we've determined that, we've gone through in a previous webinar that's focused on the Yocto project, and you can refer to that webinar for details on how we've determined that we need to use the I2C4 bus, right? So all we did was basically just create this addition to the existing device tree with this particular customization, and we're simply going to add that to our base image, right? So to do that, we're going to run DTO apply, and we're going to specify the device tree. Again, how this device tree is determined, we go through in that webinar on the Yocto project using the Toradex SOM and carrier board. Okay, so this tells us that the device tree was successfully applied, and now we can just run a simple command to check the status, right? So we can see now that this is the device, these are the overlays that exist on this particular device tree. And now we're going to actually deploy this change. Okay, so now we've basically committed, quote unquote, this change to the base image that we have downloaded, and then finally we're going to actually deploy it. We're going to specify the IP address, username, and the password. And we're going to instruct it to reboot. Okay, and now we're simply waiting for the board to reboot. And if we simply SSH into it, we can see that we we can see that our new device has appeared, right? So if we look at cat name, we can see that this is our device tree entry. So we've, in a matter of simply like three commands, right? We've basically applied this device tree, and it took less than 15 minutes. And most of that time was actually setting up and waiting for the Torizon Core Builder a container to be downloaded and installed. The actual process of applying the device tree change itself and deploying it to the board itself was minimal, right? So this is the power that Torizon offers in reducing the complexity and minimizing the process and actually applying our customizations. Next, we will see how Torizon can streamline application development on our Linux-based embedded system. Our application will be based on Python. We are initially going to use Visual Studio Code to develop and test the application, the core application, to verify that we can get data from the sensor, similar to how we can potentially retrieve the same data on the command line. Then, we will build up Docker containers to achieve the project goals. This will consist of three containers. The first container will be our custom application, which will retrieve data from the sensor and write it to the database. The second container will be based on the available InfluxDB container, which will serve as our database. Finally, the third container will also be somewhat of a custom application that will be meant to read from the Influx database, the InfluxDB database, and visualize it. We will then make an adjustment to our custom container on how the data is stored and see its impact in the visualization process. In this first demo, we will use Visual Studio Code and the Torizon extension to develop the single Python application to make sure we can read data from the peripheral. So here, we're going to bring up Visual Studio Code. We already have the Torizon extension pre-installed, and we're going to let it initialize and load up. We can see that it's loading. We can see that it's initializing. So we're just going to let it do its thing first before we proceed. All right. So now the first thing we're going to do is we're going to want to add our device in the extension, right, to make it aware of where to load our applications and run them. Okay. So we're going to make sure that we connect it over the network connection, right? We specified the IP address, username, and password, right? Password is test. It's a contrived password. It's not for production purposes. And now our board has actually rebooted, and the extension is going to try to connect to the board. Now the board has rebooted, and we can see a fair bit of information about the board itself and what's on there. So, right, so we have images. So there are containers that come pre-installed with the image that we installed. And these are the images. These are the containers that already exist. This was something that we've done previously for testing purposes. Right, and then not only that, but we can see actually like all of the processes outside of even just a container running on our system, right? So it gives us a fair bit of information about what exists on our device along with the mount points effectively. So the first thing we're going to want to do is create a Python application, right? So we're going to just do Control Shift P. We're going to select Torizon. We're going to type Torizon Python. Going to create a Python application. I'm going to call it SHT31 test. Okay. We're going to select the directory, where this is going to go. Okay. And it's just going to be a simple Python application. We're going to want to make sure that we select ARM64 because our board is a IMX8. And so now the extension is actually creating the necessary infrastructure for our application, right? So we didn't really have to do much to get us going, right? All we really need to focus on is creating the application, right? So everything is kind of pre-configured for us. There's a sample application that's already been created and running. And now the only thing that we actually need to do, just for the sake of making sure that things are working, is if we go to run and start debugging, the extension is going to take care of the process of creating an image with this application and deploying it and actually running it on the device. And we're going to see that happen. Okay. Then if we go to output, we go to the debug console, we can see Hello World being printed, and this is actually on the device itself. In order to convince ourselves that this Python application is being run on the target device, we're going to modify it a little bit and actually query the environmental sensor and display the values that are being read periodically, like once a second. So that will confirm, because again, that sensor is connected to our target board. There is no concept of, or straightforward concept of I2C on an x86 PC. So we're not connecting our device to the PC, but we're connecting to our board. So if we query the SysFS entries that represent the temperature and humidity data, that that runs successfully and it's being displayed in this debug console, then that would be strong confirmation that the Python application is being executed on the target device. So just gonna code up a simple application here. Here we're just importing the time library from Python, just because we want to be able to sleep every second in between reads. We initialize one variable for temperature, another variable for humidity. We have an infinite loop, which constantly queries the SysFS entry that's representative of the temperature data. It's another SysFS entry from the driver that's representative of the humidity data, and we just print it out onto the debug console. Or onto the console on the device, and then the extension forwards that along to Visual Studio Code for us to view it here, right? So if this were to be actually being executed on my host PC, my native PC, this would throw an exception because these files are not present, right? Because my sensor isn't connected and the driver isn't built into my kernel. So we run it. We can see that the temperature and humidity data is being queried from the sensor, and we can see that there's slight fluctuations especially the humidity, and we see temperature change a little bit, which is a strong indication that this Python application is being packaged together by the Torizon extension, deployed to the device, and executed on the device. And also, any sort of output that this Python application produces is forwarded to Visual Studio Code in this debug console. So again, this is a very powerful tool and extension in Visual Studio Code that eliminates most, if not all, of the infrastructure and grunt work that we would need to do to be able to run this Python application on the device. And instead, we can focus on coding and debugging and testing our application. In the next demo, we're going to modify the existing application to interface with the database, and then integrate it with existing Docker, integrate existing Docker containers that serve as the basis of our database, which is InfluxDB, with our own, run it, and then see the final visualization that we'd hope to see. Okay, so we already have our set of containers already composed, and basically for this demo, we've actually taken an example multi-Docker container example from Toradex's own set of samples, modified it a little bit to use the actual driver instead of querying I2C, and then post that data into a database, and then using the Flask app container to read from that database and present it on a web interface. So to summarize, there's two And we've kind of organized all of this using Docker Compose. So basically we have in our Docker Compose file, we have one container, right, which is just a standard container from Docker Hub, right, which is just InfluxDB. We have another container, which is our own custom, which is one of the two custom containers, which is this interface between the our sensor and the database. And then the last is also a custom container, which basically just uses, which retrieves data from the InfluxDB database and then presents that data on a web application, right? That can be seen by which is going to be seen by our host PC, right? So the way to do this, so if we just kind of briefly go through the actual implementation of our custom Docker container that queries data from the environmental sensor and puts it in the database, right? We can just see that it's querying the database, right? Again, it's doing something similar that we just demonstrated, which is just querying sensor data from the sensor, right? Querying the sensor data, and then basically writing it to the database, right? And then if we look at this module, right? All this is doing is just reading that same file that we were just reading in the previous example, okay? And then if we go up to the other container, right? This is really, all this is doing is, this is just querying data from the database, right? And then just presenting it as an interface, right? So we're gonna see how that works, right? So this is, Flask is a pretty standard framework to present, to basically serve up a web interface for a core Python application, okay? So what we're going to do is we're actually just going to transfer this folder to our device. Oops. And then we're just going to use Docker Compose. Up, and then we're not going to detach it because we want to actually see what's going on. Okay, so here we can see it's actually building up the entire, like the three Docker containers, right? It's pulling the Influx database from Docker Hub, and it's building up, or it's built up our existing, our custom Docker containers for our applications, okay? So now it's going through the process of just building up the Docker container. Right, and this first step takes a long time just because it's going through the initial process of setting up all the containers and creating the infrastructure that we want, right? So it's pulling all of these utilities for the individual containers themselves. Okay, so it's still continuing. This initial steps just takes a little bit of time. So now we're seeing that it's going through the process of actually creating our custom container, right, which is, it's building up the SHT-31 interface. Yeah, because this is a problem here. Right, don't want this. do this again. And this time, this process should be a lot quicker because it's pre-built a lot of the existing containers.
Right, and we just needed to make the change to one of the containers, really. Now it's building the flask app container, right? So now it's finally putting together all the containers into the entire application. Okay, so now we can see that our actual application is running, right? So because we didn't put it in detach mode, we're actually seeing things are happening, right? So if we open up a web page to the IP address and port, right, we can see it, our measurements are coming in, right? So this is kind of real-time measurement, and this is like history that if we wanted to query, we can see what's going on. Okay. Now we will see a demo of how we can modify a container to change how data is stored in the InfluxDB database and see the effect it has on the visualization of this of the same data, but it's just stored in a different manner. So here we can see basically in our existing container implementation on the left-hand side on the y-axis, we can see that the units for temperature are in units of millicelsius, right? So that's why we see such a large values. And similarly for humidity as well, it's in millipercent, right? So that's why we have such large values in this visualization. So if we go ahead and exit out of our container, right, stop our container, and then simply change how data is just stored in our database, right? So all we're going to do is instead of storing it as ints, we're going to store them as floats and in proper units, right? So they're no longer in units of milli, they're of millicelsius and millipercent, but they're true Celsius temperature and true humidity percentage, okay? So the only thing we need to do is rebuild our set of Docker containers, right? And then just bring them up again, right? So Docker is, it's not changing the InfluxDB container because nothing changed. It's simply recreating and rebuilding our containers where we've made changes, right? That includes the container where we're storing data from. So we let that finish, right? We allow for the Flask app to come up. And now once we reload the web page, we can see the effect that it has. So now on the left-hand side on the y-axis, we can see that the data is in units of true Celsius, right? And true humidity percentage, right? So went from thousands of units to tens of units, right? And so we can see that changing, This is, in my opinion, in my experience, a common workflow for data science sorts of applications. You want to make a change on how data is stored in a database, and you want to see the effect it has on further down in your pipeline, just because changing how data is presented and stored may give you a different insight that can help facilitate the end goal that you're trying to achieve. To recap, we've demonstrated how Torizon Core Builder can simplify and streamline the process of modifying Linux to meet the needs of our custom hardware.
We've observed how the Torizon extension for Visual Studio Code significantly reduces the legwork to assemble infrastructure. This allows us to focus solely on writing and testing the code for our final application. We've also identified how multiple containers can be combined to form a single application and deployed onto the target hardware. We can combine our own custom containers with our custom application with pre-built containers from Docker Hub to minimize any rework that's necessary. We've also demonstrated how we can make an adjustment to cut one container, rebuild it, deploy it to our target hardware, and see the overall impact on the application. Now we will see the deployment strategies that Torizon offers. We will only briefly discuss them here without going into much detail. More detail will be provided in a future webinar. We've already seen an example of a deployment strategy that Torizon already provides. When we were working through the OS customization demo, we saw how Torizon Core Builder can be used to create a custom image with a device tree overlay and then deploy the resulting image to the board. This is especially valuable during the developmental stage when we can test the complete image and iron out issues as needed. Torizon offers a web interface to support strategies that are more typical for deploying devices out in the field. A clean web interface includes much of the necessary functionality. For example, devices can be added and provisioned. They can be organized into groups, referred to as fleets. This can be valuable in partitioning devices into groups for different teams across your organization. For example, developers can have a set of devices that can be used to deploy and test images that are being currently worked on. A system test team can have their own fleet so that they can deploy images that have been released by developers on their test units. Finally, a production manager can have their own fleet or multiple fleets, which are devices that are out in the field. The web interface also allows the team to upload software for staging purposes before they are deployed. The software can consist of single or multiple Docker containers or full-blown custom OS images. Finally, the web interface can be used to dictate how software is loaded across different devices. Here we see the main interface of the Torizon web interface. We have multiple options on the left and in the middle to manage our devices, software packages, and fleets. As you can see, software already provided by Toradex already is populated in the middle section under the software packages. If we click on the option called Provision Device under the devices portion, we are presented with a fairly straightforward Docker command to execute on the device so that it can be added to our ecosystem. We also see an option to allow us to observe device metrics, which would be useful to see how the device behaves when executing our application or running our application out in the field. If we click on the option to add a new package in the middle of the dashboard, we can see two options for software packages for staging. We can either add a single or multiple container application based on Docker, or we can upload a complete custom OS image. Finally, if we click on the option to add a fleet in the third column, we can see the process is initiated to allow us to create a fleet and ultimately add devices. Remember, these slides provide a cursory overview of the Torizon web interface. As mentioned, a more detailed review will occur in a future webinar. And that concludes this webinar. To summarize, we saw the typical embedded system workflow and how Torizon can help simplify and streamline the process. We saw how to use Torizon at different stages of this workflow with demonstrations and examples. Finally, we discussed how Torizon enables a complete and centralized deployment environment. I hope you enjoyed the webinar and thank you for your attendance. Remember, there will be a future webinar that goes into detail about the Torizon web interface along with examples and demonstrations. To stay up to date on when that will happen, I remind you to join MabLab's BIOS Food newsletter. You can scan this QR code to sign up.
All right. Thank you, everybody, for participating in the webinar. We're going to go right into the question and answer session. So just going to start off with a few questions that people already had. So one question is, what are some CI strategies, continuous integration strategies that can be used for Torizon customization? So one strategy that I think is valuable is that if you basically have your baseline Torizon image. You can basically have your customizations in your own repository and then run a script periodically that whenever something changes in your repository, somebody in your development team makes a change, it would go through the process of pulling down the base image, applying your customizations, and then generating the new image to whatever sort of kind of artifact tree based like image repository that you have. So that's kind of one strategy that I think is pretty valuable. Drew, I don't know if you had any other kind of strategies that could be valuable for based on your own experience.
Can you, am I coming through on audio okay?
Yep.
Yeah. Okay, excellent. Yeah, I'm not sure what's going on. Camera's not letting me turn on my camera, but yeah, it's pretty straightforward, right? Any of our tools can be plugged in to a CI system. We are in the process of developing a REST API for the platform components. You know, today you can call the Torizon Core Builder tool directly just from a shell script, but eventually you'll be able to actually have more complete interactions with a server over that REST API. So that should open up a lot of interesting use cases, you know, but it is very common, you know, just have your nightly builds go out to one specific fleet, you know, your testing fleet and that kind of thing. So the design goal specifically related to CI/CD was to be, you know, kind of agnostic of which CI/CD system in and just make it easy to plug in, because obviously we don't want to replicate all that extra activity.
Excellent. Cool. Thank you. Second question that somebody had is, what is the performance impact of using containers and embedded? Isn't it overkill? Drew, what are your thoughts on that?
I think it's essentially minimal. There's a little bit of runtime overhead at the start of launching a container, but once the containers are up and running, they're standard Linux processes. It's not like there's a separate task switching runtime on top of the standard Linux task switching setup. So it just uses different fields inside the existing task control block to set C groups and things like that. There is a little bit of overhead as far as disk is concerned. And if you're not careful about, you know, utilizing the same base containers, you could end up pulling in different versions of dependent packages, which could bloat your storage needs. But, you know, that also gives you the flexibility if you have the need to, you know, for instance, support different versions of the C library for different pieces of code, you can do that, which obviously with without a containerized subsystem, you can't do. So obviously it's a trade-off there. Docker is very good about, you know, layering things properly, and where two containers depend on the same piece underneath, it will be able to reuse that layer. So Docker is very good about handling that. So for most embedded designs that use our systems, I don't think the overhead of containers is a real big concern.
Excellent. Yeah, I agree too. I think it's just at the startup, and then under the hood, it's actually pretty performant in how containers are actually executed. Cool. Yep. Next question I guess somebody had is, how does Torizon OTA differ from deployments using like Torizon Core Builder and or the IDE extension in Visual Studio Code, for example?
Sure. Yeah. So, I mean, Torizon OTA is intended to be deploying to devices in the field, right? Whereas Torizon Core Builder is really intended to be a development tool. And Torizon Core Builder under the covers actually SSHs into the board and transfers the files in the OS tree, the OS tree objects that it needs over SSH. So it's not really, Torizon Core Builder is really intended to be a local area network kind of setup where you know, you have SSH access to your boards and that kind of thing. But, you know, once you go into production, then the expectation is that you would move over to the OTA system, which is built on a security framework called Uptain to, you know, properly manage keys and give you the best security possible for your devices deployed in the field.
Cool. Excellent. I guess the next question that somebody had is, what kinds of changes are out of scope for Torizon Core Builder? When would when would I need to do a custom Yocto build of the base OS? So I think that's usually reserved for like really core, if you wanted to change the kernel for whatever reason and you needed to kind of create a base image, or you know, if you had let's say a core set of containers that everybody in your organization had to have because that's what your product line kind of enabled. I think like there's argument to be had that where you could just create your own custom base image and then that could be the baseline. So just for the former, like I've had to modify kind of drivers just in my experience because, and these are core kernel drivers, just because there's some minor kind of nuances to the hardware. It didn't make sense to create like a separate kernel module or driver. It just made sense to just go ahead and just make slight tweaks to the existing kernel, the existing kind of in-tree kernel driver, and that was it. And so I think for that sort of purpose, like creating a new base image based on kind of, again, the Yocto project, and then having my base image that I can kind of, that's targeted to my specific hardware, that then you can kind of build up the rest of the image. What are your thoughts, Drew?
Yeah, I mean, mechanically speaking, Torizon Core Builder can build out of tree kernel drivers. It can build modified device tree blobs, but it is unable to change the existing kernel. So if you need to enable a kernel config that's not enabled in the default build, Torizon Core Builder today doesn't have any mechanism to do that. If you need to enable, say, another in-tree kernel driver, we don't have the ability to do that with Torizon Core Builder. So that at that point, you would have to go back to the Yocto build, much like you were describing there for, you know, building your custom thing. But if your custom carrier board is serviceable with only device tree updates and out of tree kernel drivers, then you can skip the Yocto build entirely.
Right. Cool. Next question that somebody had is Torizon open source?
Yes.
Okay.
the Yocto layers are all available on our GitHub, and the instructions are available on our developer website for you'd be able to build your own. Obviously, if you're doing for our users to be able to do a fully custom Yocto build, they would need access to those layers. The platform components, the hosted component, that is not published, although it is based on some other open source projects and uses standards that way. So there has been talk of turning that into having a service where you could self-host the platform components, but today that's not available.
Got it. Okay, excellent. Next question is, can Torizon be used for boards from other providers, for example, the Raspberry Pi?
Well, conceptually, yes. We don't port it to those boards or test it on those boards. But there's nothing in our hardware that would preclude it from going on to other boards. There has been some talk internally of potentially supporting some other platforms moving forward, but nothing concrete at the moment.
Cool. Next question. What is the best way to deploy an application to multiple devices at once? I would say kind of using kind of the web interface, right? What are your thoughts?
Yeah, that's definitely what the OTA, our OTA component of our platform is intended for. So within that web user interface, you'll define fleets, which are essentially groups of devices. And then when you're ready to issue a deployment, whether that's the base OS or just the containers, the target of that deployment is either a single device or a fleet. So, if you have, this is, for instance, how you would get your nightly builds out to your test devices and that kind of thing, it would be a single deployment.
Cool. Is there anything like menu config and build root? I mean, I think like it's just like I guess because Torizon is based on the Yocto project, it's just a different paradigm of doing things. Like it's generally not based on menu config, and so like I don't like you would have if you wanted to basically. And I think like this question is asking because they may want to customize the baseline like core image, which I guess they think they would need to use the Yocto project. I mean, that's a different set of paradigms. I don't think that there's like an equivalent to menu config. Like you'd have to go through the route of making recipes and adding your own recipes to the base image. Do you agree?
Yeah, definitely. I mean, if you're, you would end up using the Yocto mechanisms to customize the base OS. As far as customizing the application stacks, the IDE extension does provide some configurability. It's mechanically very different from menu config, but there are, you know, drop downs and things within the IDE configuration. Within the IDE extension, where you can set configurations for your containers and that kind of thing.
Excellent. And similarly, like I guess it was a follow up about the graphical interface. I mean, I think to the extent where the graphical interface comes in, I think the Visual Studio or the Torizon extension kind of serves as that graphical interface. I mean, it's pretty extensive in my opinion. And then again, the OTA interface to do like Torizon web updates is also like a pretty extensive kind of graphical interface. I think anything more involved than kind of what we discussed in this webinar would require kind of more command line interaction. What do you think, Drew?
Yeah, I wonder if this question is more about the graphical interface on the device itself. In which case, we run containers, so anything that can run in a container can run on a device. We do have reference containers for things like Wayland and Weston. We have a number of third-party partners that we work with that provide different graphical frameworks. So if you use Windows Forms or .NET or whatever, we do have some reference containers for that. If you want to run Xorg or Wayland Weston, those are all supported, and we can help you out with reference containers for that.
Cool. Awesome. One other question is, my version of VS Code doesn't have certain Torizon commands for the OTA, interface. How would I fix that? My understanding is that the extension is not really meant for the OTA. It's really just meant for like your local interface. Is my understanding correct?
Mostly, although over time we are adding additional functionality to the extension. I know some stuff is available in if you look in the extension store with VS Code, there's actually two versions of the Torizon extension. There's the released one, and then there's the early access one. And obviously the early access is more buggy, but it's also where all the latest features come in. So you might, if you haven't looked at the early access version, you might take a look at that. That may provide what you need. Otherwise, if you have a specific use case, if you want to type in another question, I can see if I can answer more directly for your specific use case.
They're asking they're trying to just push from Visual Studio Code to the platform. So, that should be a pretty standard use case in the existing IDE extension. We kind of saw that right now where it was, you just needed to hit the start debugging option in Visual Studio Code, and it would kind of take care of pushing your application out to the device.
Right. Yeah. So the existing, right, if you just hit the F5 key or whatever it is to start debugging, right, that uses the local SSH connection. I'm checking right now to see. I know that there was some discussion of having the extension be able to push directly to the OTA. I'm not sure if it's been released or not. I don't see it obviously in the list of commands that I have here. But if it's not there, it is definitely something we're working on developing.
Excellent. One other question is, can we cross compile Qt's application projects? Using integration with Qt Creator?
That's something I don't have a good answer for. I know some people have used Qt Creator, and we've done some sample Qt stuff through the extension, but I believe Qt Creator is not directly plugged in through the extension. Although, if you're developing your Qt app and you create a Docker image around it, you can always just use standard Docker command line commands to get access to that new image.
Excellent. I guess the follow-up question to the previous question about the Visual Studio Code extension for OTA updates, I guess they're asking, is it reserved for a premium tier of the Torizon subscription?
No, the main difference between the free tier and the paid tiers at the moment is the ability to upload custom base OS images. So if you want to do a customized base OS, you need the paid tier. Although typically, if you're in early development on a product, we're happy to credit that to your account for, you know, during your development time. If you have access to a Toradex sales rep, they can certainly help you with that. If you don't, you can drop me a note directly, and I can put you in touch with the right people to start those discussions.
Great, excellent. I think that's all the questions we have so far. I thank everybody in participating with the webinar. It was great. And I especially, again, would like to thank Toradex for their tremendous support in not only the technical side of things, but also in helping promote and help run the webinar itself. And Drew, do you have any final thoughts or words that you'd like to share with the group?
I want to thank everybody for your time. Obviously, there's a lot of content out there, and we know your time is very valuable. So definitely want to thank you for attending, and hope that you got what you needed out of it. And if you have further questions, you can find us on developer.toradex.com, or you can email us directly, and we'll do what we can to get you the information.
All right. Thank you, everybody. Really appreciate everybody participating. Take care.
Bye now.